Now is Zara Abilo of the Council on American Islamic Relations and Trita Parsi, president of the National Iranian American Council. Let me start with you, Zara. How do you react to a executive order that is clearly targeting people based on their religion?
Thank you so much for having me. Honestly, it's been a mixed bag. Anger is a very common reaction. It's what I've been feeling. This president promised a racist ban targeting Muslims and others from Muslim-majority countries for months. We should have expected that he would attempt to fulfill it. And what's most concerning is the level of fear that we're seeing from impacted individuals. Can they come in? What does it mean when a pregnant woman gets stuck at San Francisco Airport for several hours? How are elderly people dealing with the fact that they may need to take two very long flights, one sending them back to their country of origin because of this executive order? So anger is what I'm feeling. Fear is what I'm seeing in a lot of the community members that we serve.
And Trita, a lot of people that are not Muslim have absolutely joined the protest, joined the outrage. Many of us have been saying for months this is something that is a threat to everyone. But once you see it actually implemented, it really does raise the level of outrage and fear. I mean, we're actually talking about an executive order that is based on who you are in terms of your religion or in terms of your background, and not based on any thing that you've done to raise suspicion. Is this unprecedented from where you sit?
Well, unfortunately, these things have happened in this country before, but it's been quite a while. And you're absolutely right. The principle that this is based on is probably the most threatening thing and the most scary thing of all of this, because it essentially means that people are going to be judged because of their DNA, because of their religion, not because of their conduct. And if this is a principle that gets established and becomes normalized, we're going to see some very, very nasty things happening in this country. And I think it's bear reminding that this is not just targeting people with visas. This is actually now targeting people with green cards, people who have been living here for 20 years, whose children are American, who may have gone on a business trip and cannot get back to their children as a result of this. This is truly stunning and shocking, and I'm not surprised at all to see that the entire world is just stunned that America could do something like this.
Now, Zara, when you mentioned that there was fear, we just had a report in Atlanta. There was a child that was held. You mentioned a pregnant woman. Is part of this fear also that it begins to stereotype Muslims who are in the country and kind of give this blanket image that all of them are suspects of terrorism?
I would say the fear is twofold. First, we have someone holding the highest elected office in this country continuing to spew racist, Islamophobic rhetoric, and now attempting to put forward policy based on that. So this makes people who were otherwise considering hate crimes but wouldn't have done them feel emboldened, feel like they are on the correct side of things, and feel like they have the support of the president. The other part of the fear I would note, though, is that this executive order starts with seven countries and certain time limits on the various restrictions it puts into place. But what we've heard from some Republican leaders right here on MSNBC is that they may add additional countries later. And so what we permit to happen today will continue to have a impact, a ripple effect on other Americans beyond just the seven countries. And that's a source of fear. We're hearing from people from Pakistan, people from Sri Lanka, people from Malaysia who are asking, well, what does this mean for me and can I travel at this time?
And as you point out, I think it is important to bring back, Trita, that this also impacts people with green cards. I mean, for people at home this morning, tell them actually what the practical implications of this order is, because I don't know that people really understand when we say ban, what does that really mean? Who is banned and what does it do to those that are banned, Trita?
So it's targeting individuals who have been born in seven countries and have citizenship in those countries. Now, when they first talked about this earlier on, it gave the impression that it would be banning new visas and immigration from those countries. There was no hint that it would also be targeting people who already have visas, or that it would be targeting people who already live here and have been living here for years because they are green card holders.
So if you have a visa, if you've been living here for years, you still fall under this ban.
Absolutely, and this is the thing. There are students here from these countries. About 48% of the people that are affected by this are Iranians, because that's the biggest group in this. A lot of students here, if they travel outside of the country right now, they're not going to be able to be let back in. And also, I think one thing that I want to mention that people really should be aware of, the green card holders been interrogated and then decided on a case-by-case basis whether they can come in or not. I've spoken to people who have been let in, and I also spoken to people who have been deported. The people who have been let in told me that they were handcuffed, that they were interrogated for hours, they were asked for their social media and Facebook and Twitter and Instagram that was reviewed. They were also asked their view on Donald Trump. And this is pretty scary. People are walking out of this feeling that they always
people
thought that they lived
that
in the
country. People that were held were asked their views on Donald Trump? What does that have to do with anything about entering the country and about whether or not you're suspected, if that is the assumption, of doing something unlawful?
And this is exactly the point. People walk out of this extremely intimidated and feeling that they're no longer living in the land of laws, because you're being asked questions about what their views is on the president. And if they give the wrong answer, they may not have been let into the country.
This enhances, Zara, the fear that you talk about, because if you, let's say, for example, you don't agree with President Trump, are you supposed to, out of fear, say, I like the president because you want to get in the country? I mean, this is absolutely an outrage on his face on what the United States Constitution is supposed to guarantee you in this country.
I agree. I mean, and the difficult thing is that it targets the most vulnerable populations. If I were advising a U.S. citizen coming into the border, and I was told that a law enforcement or other government agent asked them about their religious or political beliefs, my advice would be to say, mind your own business. That is not a question I'm required to answer. But I can't safely say that to a green card holder or someone with a visa, because they could very well be detained and turned away, which is some of what we've seen in the last 24 to 36 hours. And so it targets people who are most vulnerable, and then it asks them about information that we as Americans believe at our core the government has no business asking us.
Trina, let me ask you quickly, I'm out of time, but a judge in Brooklyn in Eastern District stopped the deportations but did not have order that they can actually enter the country. Where are we legally here? What are the legal goals to try and deal with this executive order?
So right now where we are is that those who are already here cannot be deported until this matter has been resolved. But people who are not here, who are green card holders who are about to board a plane or students, they still would be in jeopardy if they got on. And in fact, many of them are not even going to be able to get on the planes because the airlines won't let them on.
All right.
But I think it's also important to keep one thing in mind. This is not making America safer in any way, shape, or form. This is only dividing the country, turning Americans against Americans, and dragging America's name through the mud internationally.
Well, I'm going to deal with that in the next segment, because it doesn't even really target where the terrorism that we've seen even comes from. And I'm going to deal with that in the next segment. Zara Billow, Trina Parsi, thank you both.